Welcome to the Renaissance and welcome to this edition of Negro Slavery Today, Part 1. Important notice, this video is not a propaganda or entertainment video. It is for educational, informational and reference purposes only. Please look for the referenced sources and study them yourself. Remember, although I sincerely lament the existence of the slave trade, I feel no repugnance in availing myself of the means it affords me of supplying by purchase the number of Negroes requisite for the management of my plantations, Jacob Lewis, 1797, and this is from the book Instructions for the Treatment of Negroes, published 1797. And from Thomas Arrow Cobb, the Negro among the Jews, as everywhere he is found, was of a proscribed race. He was even forbidden to approach the altar to offer the bread of his God. And this is from the book An Inquiry into the Law of Negro Slavery in the United States of America, published 1858. The slave trade today. Do you remember when we mentioned a move by the slave master and his slave hunting partners in anticipation of the end of oil and in anticipation of the end of paper money? If yes or no, whichever one it is, have you examined the slave master's response to Biafra and Ambazonia struggles for freedom? Do you also remember when we said Biafra and Ambazonia today are the easiest way to understand the slave trade, and that they are also one of the easiest ways to know that the slave master's religions of Islam and Christianity are bogus and deceptive? Have you ever wondered why the same people that say we are all Africans work more with the slave masters and his slave hunting partners against the Negroes? Did you know that the same way abolition was considered as sedition during the slave trade is how something like Biafra and Ambazonia, ideally freedom, is considered today? That is to say, asking for freedom from any of the slave master's contraptions, especially those in the slave coast like Nigeria and Cameroon, is akin to how it was at that time to condemn the slave trade, or for Negroes to ask for freedom. And so, do you remember during the lockdown when we said if you wanted to know whether or not the virus was real, that you should look at their slave hunting partners because of their lack of humanity and common sense, that they were going to give the game away? Did you also remember when we said that the lockdown was planned by the slave master and his slave hunting partners and that the targets were the Negroes? And did you see when during the lockdown we saw the slave master and his slave hunting partners moving down south, that is in what is Nigeria today, they were just pushing their boys down to what was the southern part of the country while beating people and forcing them to stay indoors? Did you notice that game there? If yes, why do you think they were doing that? Just think about why you think they could be doing that. Remember, if you never knew before now, it is part of their jihad. And what you are going to be seeing more will be a situation where girls will be raped a lot. That's their subtle way of producing children of mixed blood within the Negroes, the same way they did during the slave trade. If you notice today, the Fulanis today are darker. Those are products of the real Fulanis of the past who were fairer and Negro slaves. You don't need to believe us, you just need to see them do it. And you will be noticing increased rape in what you will call southern part of Nigeria today. Remember, they can tell you it is part of global warming that they have to move their cattle down south. But if you knew the history, that that's what they've been doing, you will also understand why they were sending boys. If you notice in the crowd that they were moving during the lockdown, they were males. And if you kept your eyes open, you will notice increased cases of rape in the area. That's what they'll be doing. Remember, it's easy to say other people do rape too. But if you notice, the southerners could be armed robbers, but they go out to steal out of hunger and deprivation coming from the state of the area. But these ones will be out just for rape. if you doubt what we're saying, just do basic research. Remember, you can't take them to the police. Even if you took them to the police, they'll be released the next day. You can't do anything to them. That's the price you pay. And that's why you notice that the slave master insists on one Nigeria or one Cameroon, because he needs his slave hunting partners in the same space with the Negroes, because the ultimate goal is to obliterate that race from the planet Earth. You don't need to believe us, you will see it happen. And perhaps you laughed at us when we mentioned that there was a relationship between the lockdown and COVID-19 and the slave trade. At least if you looked at Ebola, for example, and remember how they did something akin to what they did recently and the monkeypox vaccines, all you need to do is to connect the dots and ask yourself why they didn't start forcing people at that time to take the Ebola. It will simply show you that they tried that system, it didn't work. They now went back to the drawing board. All they are looking for is a pretext under which to do certain things, which we cannot just tell you, but we encourage you to research them yourself. The slave master is never smart, but he's a subtle beast. And if you still remember when we said that the easiest way to understand the slave trade and the culprits is Biafra and Ambazonia freedom struggles of today, what does the slave master's silence to the killings by their slave hunting partners tell you? Remember, when their slave hunting partners massacre innocent people in communities, you won't see the BBC there. You won't see the BBC interview people. Instead, they will go and arrange some people and start asking them questions that try to suggest that no one was killed. And if you remember, the US has joined them. That's why you notice that even after their fake news CNN had reported killings during the NSAS protests, you'll see that they have come to say nobody was killed. That's exactly how they even claimed that it was the Negroes selling themselves. Remember, if they could be lying to us today that we can see what is going on, imagine what they could have done in the past. And in the event you never knew about the Biafra-Nigerian War of 1967-70, it was the same gang up, which is what they are trying to do presently. And if you remember at that time, part of what they did was they will go and massacre innocent people in some communities, and then the BBC will tell the world that it was done by the Biafrans. Then they were called rebels. So you understand that every problem going on there is coming from the British and their policy of ruling through the Fulanese. And so permit us to ask you, why do you think they always gang up against the Negroes? Remember, the slave trade was done the same way. During the Biafran War, the Arabs, the Europeans, the Americans, all of them ganged up together against tiny Biafra. Have you ever asked yourself why? And in the event you think you are not a Biafran, or what concerns you with Biafra, or if you are from the southwestern part of Nigeria or the Middle Belt, one thing you have to bear in mind is the history of the area was about the slave trade, and the Fulanese, being Arabs that they were then, are still doing what they were doing back then till today. That's why you notice that if they massacre anybody or killed anybody, nobody arrests them. They just go free. The slave master won't even report it. That's part of their game, the same thing they did back then. And we strongly believe that if you can open your mind to what the slave master is doing today, it will expose his religions as false, both Islam and Christianity. And it will also expose the fact that they have been working together and they did the slave trade together. All you need to do is to watch both parties, watch the slave master and his slave hunting partners, and it will help you understand who the culprits of the slave trade were as at that time and still are till today. And so, the Negroes were just one group, but balkanized by the slave master and his slave hunting partners, from Coromantis to Mandingos and Igbos and all those appellations, the slave master coined and created all of them. That's why you notice that if somebody from England is called an English, it's an English word, both sides. But if you looked at the words that represent the identities or appellations the Negroes bear, most of them do not have meanings in the languages they supposedly came from. That's because the slave master coined them. If you doubt what we're saying, one simple way to try to understand what games they are playing would be to try changing the names that are badly spelt in some of those areas. Let's say you wanted to replace a name like Oweri with Oweri or Aweri as they wrote it in the past, and see what the slave master and his slave hunting partners would do. Also, if you remembered what we said about the so-called African Americans asking for reparations from the governments in the areas where the slave trade happened, and see the body language of both the slave master and his slave hunting partners. Remember, if they started demanding for that, the conscience of the slave hunters will be opened. Likewise, the slave master will be afraid that he will also be caught. So that's why they fight very hard to make sure that both sides are separated, and that's why they came up with the Aboriginal narrative. You don't need to believe us, you just need to look at the historical records and look at the slave master and his slave hunting partners and what they are doing today. And so, please investigate when these identities first came into existence. Yoruba, now called Yoruba, Efik, Ibibio, Ejo, Anang, Nigeria, Ghana, Niger or Niger Republic or whatever you choose to call it, Togo, Benin, and Dahomey, Biafra, Ishekiri, Ikwere, Urobo, etc. Find out when they were first used in history, in any book at all. Start your research from there. It will also help you understand where they are headed to and who are Negroes today. And in the event you are still struggling with how the dots connect between Christianity, Islam, and the slave trade, or the Biafra genocide of 1967 to 1970, and the slave trade, and the response to COVID-19 / lockdown, and those movements you saw from the Sahel into Nigeria and down to the southern part during the lockdown, and things like one Nigeria and one Cameroon, and the Ebola virus and monkeypox vaccines, etc., and how they are all related to the slave trade and the Negroes today. Let us start from the Aboriginal narrative you hear about today, where the so-called African Americans and the slave master are now trying to tell us that the slave trade didn't happen, or how there were no ships at that time, or how the Negroes and Indians are now the same through the likes of the Nkalowe or Kurumu Ahau. Let us start by referencing The History of Black Africa, Volume 1, published 1961 by Andrew Sick. And here we see that this identity crisis has always been there. The slave master finds a way to create it in one way or another. And it says here, the Sudanese peoples, the entire population of West Africa and the Central Sudan, that is, the vast territory bounded by the Sahara and the Upper Guinea coast, with its imaginary continuation along 5 degrees north latitude from the Atlantic to the Nile, apart from a minor stratum of Arab and Berber elements, represent one great family of the Sudanese peoples. These peoples are related by language and to a considerable degree by culture. A large majority of them are related to one another also by origin. Among the Sudanese tribes, however, there are various nationalities of different origin. Example, the Fula of Berber origin. Remember, the Fulanese are not the same as the Negroes. So that's why you see that they do the killing, then the slave master covers for them, but then it will be Africans killing other Africans, whereas they are not the same as the people they are killing, because they live there as enemies within, planted by the slave masters. So this should explain to you why they were moving those people down south during the lockdown. Remember, if there was a lockdown, the virus should be affecting everyone. It doesn't matter who you were. But then, how come some groups were being moved down south, whereas others were forced to stay indoors in order for them not to see that movement? Always remember that. But that's totally by the way. And also ask yourself why the same thing wasn't happening elsewhere around the globe. But our main interest here is the one where it says the Sudanese peoples, and further down you see where it says, I speak of Sudanese peoples, not of Negroes, nor of Sudanese Negroes. The word Negro is essentially a contemptuous nickname, humiliating and offensive to any conscious son of the Sudanese peoples. And since this term does neither theoretically nor practically express anything positive and can thus be replaced without detriment to any scientific study by the term Sudanese peoples, therefore, it must be ignored. For the same reasons, I reject the term Negritic, once proposed by Robert Hartman, as well as the name Ethiopian, as was used by Leo Frobenius for Sudanese. This latter term may be used as a synonym for Abyssinian, since the inhabitants of Ethiopia themselves prefer that designation. The word Negro may be used only with regard to American Negroes. In America, the word Negro has ceased to be a contemptuous nickname, as this part of the American nation calls itself Negro on its own accord. But it should be noted that this opinion is not generally accepted. While certain American Negroes proudly call themselves Negroes, they speak of Negro art, Negro music, Negro history, etc. Others do their utmost to get rid of this name, replacing it by different names such as Afro-Americans or Americans of African descent, etc. Our main interest is for you to see how the identity of the Africans, or whatever you choose to call the Negroes, have been so dynamic over time. It's the same thing you see happening in Nigeria today. You see that mentioning Biafra attracts the wrath of the slave master and his slave hunting partners, because the Negro is trying to give himself his own identity. Remember, all the identities the Negroes bear must be given by the slave masters. That's what you see happening. That's why you see that somebody who is saying he wants freedom and says his identity is Biafra, then the slave master and his slave hunting partners will gang up and kill him or start fighting him for no just cause. This is the root cause of all the things you are seeing there. The Negroes trying to be free, and the slave master working very hard with his slave hunting partners against that. You don't need to believe us. What they will be doing presently will expose them further. And before we move on further, we see where it tells us that this was how large ancient states arose in the Western Sudan, Ghana about AD 300, Sonrai and Milai. The first two were founded by Berber tribes. Ghana, west of Timbuktu, northwest of the upper course of the Niger River, and Songhai, south of Timbuktu, inside the great bend of the Niger River. The state of Milai, which occupied a large territory south and east of the Niger bend, was created by the Sudanese people of the Mandingo, but was shortly afterwards subjugated by Tuaregs. And so, a quick look at the map on your screen shows you the map of Africa about 1865 and all that. But we will see where Timbuktu is, and we'll see west of Timbuktu is not where Ghana of today is. But if you looked closer at the map, you'll see clearly that all they did was just to rename their Gold Coast colony to Ghana. And of course, you see some so-called African Americans today, out of ignorance, trooping down there, thinking that it had anything to do with ancient kingdom of Ghana. And just beside the Gold Coast, you see the Slave Coast, and of course you see Benin and all those areas. But you see how carefully the Slave Coast disappeared from the map. So the Gold Coast remained, just like the Ivory Coast, which you still see today, Ivory Coast or Côte d'Ivoire. That's how you have that country. They tagged everywhere based on what they were getting from each area. The Negroes do not name wherever they are. It doesn't matter how you see it, we encourage you to research it. And going further, let us reference the religious instructions of the Negroes in the United States by Charles Jones, published 1842. And here we are told that, and so we see at the title where it says the first period, from their first introduction in 1620 to the first census in 1690, a period of 170 years. But our interest is the claim of 1620, which is just like 1619, so that you understand how smart and how subtle the slave master is. But before we go further, we see where it says, such is the scarcity of materials and the difficulty of arriving at the scattered sources of information that I have called the following historical notice of the religious instruction of the Negroes in the United States a sketch. It deserves no better name, although perhaps it may embody the principal facts on the subject. So our interest is where it says, for the sake of perspicuity, The sketch is divided into periods of time, the first period extending from the introduction of the Negroes into the country in 1620 to the first census in 1790, a period of 170 years, the second period from 1790 to 1820, a period of 30 years, and the third period from 1820 to 1842, a period of 22 years. Our interest is for you to notice this 1620, which is like 1619, give or take. But then, see what it tells us on the next page. And it says, account of the introduction of Negroes into the colonies under the government of Great Britain. Remember, there were colonies under the Spaniards. There were some under the French. There were some under the Danish and Swedish and all that. But those are not our interests. Our interest is this 1619 rubbish. And it will help you understand how the Negroes are deceived every time and all the time. And it says here that it was in the year 1501 that Isabella of Spain granted permission for the introduction of Negro slaves into Hispaniola, but such only as had been born in Spain or in slavery among Christians, and in the following year a few had been sent into the New World. In 1508, the Spaniards opened a direct trade in slaves and imported Negroes into Hispaniola from the Portuguese settlements on the coast of Guinea. Ferdinand V, by royal ordinance, enjoined a direct traffic in slaves between Guinea and Hispaniola in 1511, and Charles V in 1512 to 1513. So, in some books, we are told clearly that the Spanish colonies in what is today United States, which was a plantation then, or a collection of colonies, had Negro slaves as early as 1490s. But we are not interested in that at this time, but our interest is about the 400 years and the so-called year of return of 1619 to 2019. So our question to you, if you believe the rubbish from the so-called Hebrew Israelites and others that believe such garbage, is those who were enslaved in Europe, those who were enslaved as at 1501 and in the Hispaniola, Haiti, Jamaica and other areas and the Middle East, were they not Negroes? So is their own slavery different that you will start counting your 400 years garbage from 1619 that was given to you by the British? And further on the right, we see that the first cargo of Negro slaves was brought into Boston in 1645. And though their introduction was denounced and the Negroes ordered to be returned at public charge, yet it was afterwards permitted and people engaged in the trade. We want you to follow closely how it happens. They first start and people will condemn it, which is exactly what they want to repeat in Biafra and in Ambazonia today. If you notice, the war that is going on in Ambazonia, they are not reporting it. And unfortunately, the Negroes themselves take sides with the slave master against their own people. And as it stands, they are also gathering against Biafra, which you are going to see manifest shortly. You don't need to believe us, but we have studied the slave master to a T. He is never smart. He's just like, he's heartless, murderous, and has no iota of human feeling in him. And just for the sake of those that claim that Professor Gates telling them that only 300 and something thousand slaves were imported from Africa into what is today United States, we see here from this material that estimated Negro population of the colonies at the Declaration of Independence and Census of 1790, and the author was kind enough to say, I have no references at hand by which to determine the number of Negroes in each of the colonies, nor the aggregate in all, before the Declaration of Independence, as no general census was ever taken of the colonies while they continued such. But there are statements of the number in most of the colonies given in different years, which I shall proceed to mention. Please note that at that time, because the Negroes were not considered human, they were not counted, they were not enumerated. It doesn't matter how you say it, that's what the issue is. But they will try to tell you how they didn't have an accurate census and all that. It is the same thing that is happening in Nigeria today. The slave master will never allow an accurate census. That's why you see that the Fulanis that are in the minority are controlling everyone, because the slave master is using the Fulanis against everyone else. Let us also reference instructions for the treatment of Negroes and this was published 1797. And here we are told how they acquired the slaves. Remember, they tried to tell you that a bunch of priests who were pagans could have sold them millions of people over 400 years, whereas the average life of a human being, let's say, would be between 70 and 90 years. But they are telling us that it was the Arab priests that we first saw recorded anywhere at all in 1850s could have sold them slaves in 1430s. So that's how the slave master's lives collapse the moment you apply proper reversibility of the thought process. And so we are told here that the unhappy African, torn from his native country and his dearest connections, and sold as a slave to some relentless tyrant in a British colony. That's why you see that the British is behind all the turmoil and everything you're seeing happening there today. If you notice, the BBC is there on ground. They are obviously planning another mass massacre and bloodshed over Biafra and Ambazonia. That's why they are there. You don't need to believe us, but you just need to open your eyes and look at what will be going on there, and reduce your consumption of news from corporate media, and try to understudy what the slave master is playing at. The slave master is never smart, but he's a subtle beast and a brutal one at that. And he goes further to say, it's a mournful tale that has been told with every circumstance of aggravation that could move compassion or excite indignation. If it would avail, I could breathe sigh for sigh with those who mourn most deeply over the sad lot of this ill-fated people. And if you have studied the history to see how the rest of the world ganged up against the Negroes, which they are still doing till today, you also remember that when Trump asked the slave hunters a similar question, they simply turned against him. You can see where it says around October in 2020, "Why are you killing Christians?" Trump asks Nigeria's president. Remember, these were the slave hunters. The Nigerian president is a Fulani. They were the brutal slave hunters at that time. So that's why the British rules through the Fulanis. And so whenever you see them telling you that somebody is racist, always bear in mind that the slave master will always accuse the victim of whatever he plans to do. If he plans to dominate people, he will start telling you that this person wants to dominate you. If he's coming to steal the resources, he will tell you that this man or this group is coming to steal your resources. It's a very simple thing. So a little read here tells us that, why are you killing Christians? US President Donald J. Trump apparently shocked his Nigerian counterpart Muhammadu Buhari by asking this question the first time they met in the White House in April 2018. The Nigerian president admitted this, according to a September 8, 2020 report, towards the end of a recent talk with his cabinet members. Our interest is to show you that it's not just by shouting Trump is racist that he becomes racist. The slave master knows how to condition the Negroes to see the enemy as their friend and their friend as their enemy. The same thing you see with Lucifer, Satan, and the biblical God, or the Quran, Allah. And if you studied the biblical God closely and Allah of the Quran closely, since they now claim both are the same, it's only a problem when the Negroes have a different name for it. Because if they were the same, there is no way the Muslims would have been capturing the Negroes then, calling them pagans. And today, because they are Christians, they are still killing them. And we all see that the slave master's God, in his book, the Bible and the Quran, murdered millions. Whereas the slave master's devil killed supposedly only 10 people with permission from the slave master's God. So his own iteration or concept of God is totally a mass murderer, as against the peaceful nature one would expect from his own parent. Because there is no way you will order some of your siblings to go and kill their siblings. It's impossible. Let alone from the creator of heaven and earth. That's why they came up with their theory of natural selection and choosing some races to say these ones are superior to others. We shall look at why they are using the Fulanis in their conquest of southern Nigeria.